All right, today I'm gonna pick up where we just left off and first acknowledge that it's clear that the United States knew a great deal about what was going on during Europe while the Nazis were persecuting and murdering the Jewish population. And I'm specifically gonna talk about what Americans knew about the Holocaust as a result of the International Military Tribunal, which you all have probably heard referred to as the Nuremberg Trials. And one of the things that I want to stress is that although they are often depicted as such, the Nuremberg trials were not Holocaust trials. The intention of the Nuremberg proceedings was not to hold the Nazis accountable specifically for the crimes against the Jews, but actually for the crime of aggressive warfare. And so what you're going to see today is that in terms of educating the world about the Holocaust, the Nuremberg Trials, the International Military Tribunal, it's going to be an immediate disappointment, but it is going to be a long-term success. And so we'll talk a little bit about how that plays out. So before I start talking about the International Military Tribunal, I want to first talk about how the Holocaust had been covered in the United States by the American press. And if you take a look at the New York Times, November 11th, 1938 edition there, you will see it says, Nazis smash, loot, and burn Jewish shops and temples until Goebbels calls a halt. And this is a front page story that is covering what we refer to now as Kristallnacht, or the Night of Broken Glass. And it was on this night that more than 30,000 Jewish men were arrested across Germany. And this is a really important moment in the progression towards genocide. So people were aware of what was happening in Europe. It was very difficult for any Americans who read dailies like the New York Times to say that they had no idea what was going on in Europe. But as the war began in Europe in 1939, and the official attempt to exterminate the Jewish population began by 1941, the American press started to bury news of the Holocaust in its inner pages. And Deborah Lipstadt, the author of the book that you see here in front of you, who was at Emory University throughout her career, wrote a great study of this, and she said the information was there for people who wanted to find it, but it wasn't readily available. It wasn't very often on the front page of the newspaper, and therefore it made it not as well known, and also a little bit unbelievable. And so this played a real, or it had a real negative impact on what Americans thought about the Holocaust. Now, by the end of the war, not only was the American public aware of what was going on in Europe, but American soldiers and American diplomats were aware as well. And one of the people who went out to get a firsthand view of what the Nazis had done was General Dwight D. Eisenhower. And when Eisenhower went to visit the Dachau concentration camp, he said, "The things I saw beggar description. The visual evidence and the verbal testimony of starvation, cruelty, and bestiality were overpowering. I made the visit deliberately in order to be in a position to give firsthand evidence of these things if ever, in the future, there develops a tendency to charge these allegations merely to propaganda." And so the question, since people were very aware of what had happened, was how to handle the Nazis who had been responsible for overseeing the systematic attempt to execute more than 10 million Jews in Europe. And as you know, the number that you often hear for the success was 6 million. Now, who was around? Adolf Hitler had taken his own life. Heinrich Himmler, the head of the Schutzstaffel, the SS, had taken his own life as well. And so you had Hermann Göring, who was the number two ranked Nazi. Hans Frank was the general governor, the general government of Poland, which is where most of the death camps were located. Julius Streicher was a Nazi propaganda artist. He was the head of the Nazi newspaper. Alfred Rosenberg was a racial theorist. And then the man in the middle was Ernst Kaltenbrunner, and he was the highest remaining member of the SS. And so he would represent the SS at the International Military Tribunal. But when you consider what a lot of these men were responsible for, it wasn't really evident that they should have a day in court. And so a lot of Americans, a lot of Brits, felt like we should just summarily execute these men. We shouldn't give them a trial. And at various points throughout the Second World War, President Roosevelt of the United States, Joseph Stalin of the Soviet Union, and Winston Churchill in England all signed off on plans to simply summarily execute these men without trial. And it was largely because of the efforts of the man that you see on the screen in front of you, Justice Robert H. Jackson, that war crimes trials actually took place. Robert Jackson was a Supreme Court justice. He had been appointed by Franklin Roosevelt, and Jackson, to this day, is the last Supreme Court justice to have not attended law school. He was a self-taught lawyer. He was a man who basically studied his way into the profession. And Jackson believed that in order to set ourselves apart from the Nazis, we had to have legitimate trials. The Nazis had to have defense. They had to be given information in their own language. People could not say that these trials were simply a case of victor's justice. And so Jackson was able to successfully lobby for war crimes proceedings, and those proceedings ended up taking the shape of the IMT, the International Military Tribunal. At the IMT, there were judges from the United States, Great Britain, France, and the Soviet Union. And the charges that were leveled against the Nazis were conspiracy to commit crimes against peace, war crimes, and crimes against humanity, crimes against peace, war crimes, and crimes against humanity. And so that conspiracy charge there really encapsulated a lot of the others. But the charge that Jackson was most concerned with was crimes against peace. He believed that in order to prevent something like the Second World War from happening again, aggressive warfare had to be made illegal. And so he downplayed crimes against humanity, he focused on crimes against peace or aggressive warfare, and he did that as well in his opening statement. He really tried to take attention away from the 22 Nazi, or actually 21, one of them wasn't there, 21 Nazi defendants who were present in Nuremberg for the opening, and he made it clear that the trial was not about retribution, it was about the future. And the correspondents who were there largely followed his lead. At the time that the IMT began, it was the largest press event in history. Never before had journalists gathered in the same place, or so many journalists gathered in the same place to cover an event. There were 80 journalists, American journalists there, including Walter Cronkite, who you will see pictured there. John Dos Passos, a famous American literary figure, was a correspondent there as well. And throughout the trial, these correspondents, as I said, followed Jackson's lead. And so American press coverage focused on aggressive warfare, it downplayed the fate of Nazi defendants, and it always treated crimes against humanity as secondary. That doesn't mean, however, that the International Military Tribunal wasn't extremely important to our current understanding of the Holocaust. During the prosecution of Ernst Kaltenbrunner, the representative of the SS, Rudolf Höss, who was the commandant of Auschwitz, was called in to testify on behalf of Rudolf Höss, of Ernst Kaltenbrunner. And when he was on the stand, he detailed operations at Auschwitz. He talked about the construction and the operation of the gas chambers, and he actually overestimated. He believed that he had overseen the murder of more than 3 million people at Auschwitz. The number is more around 1.1 million. But the reason I put that in there is that he really wasn't trying to hide anything. He wasn't holding anything back. He was being very forthcoming about what he had done at Auschwitz. Hermann Göring, the number two Nazi, was also prosecuted, and he had played a leading role in the Holocaust. And specifically here, you can see, in July 1941, Göring had authorized Reinhard Heydrich, who was a leading figure in the SS, to coordinate the, quote, final solution to the Jewish question. And a lot of historians, whereas we don't have a Hitler order for the Holocaust, a lot of people point to this as the closest thing that you're ever going to get. And during the questioning of Goering, during the prosecution of Goering, a tremendous amount of information about the Holocaust was made available to the public. The American press covered this information, but as you can see, they once again buried it deep inside the paper. And so the first article, New Evidence Ties Kaltenbrunner to Atrocities in German Camps. The second article, Ribbentrop, who was the foreign minister, admits anti-Semitic moves. And then over the next article, Survivor graphically testifies on the pogrom that drove Jews from Bavarian town. The last article, Nazi race theorist pleads his innocence, but then it goes on to talk about how he believed that the Jews had betrayed Germany. So pages 10, pages 12, pages 10. Your average American never made it to page 10 or page 12 of a publication like the New York Times, in much the same way that you all only scrolled so far today when you were looking at your cell phones. Since I know you all don't actually read newspapers, I don't either, at least not in shape or form, that's the way you should think about it. You know, how far down are you willing to scroll? And so the International Military Tribunal was an immediate disappointment. The Jewish community and people advocating for the Jewish community didn't believe that enough had been done to highlight the crimes against the Jews. And in some cases, Jews were not allowed to even speak in their native language, because the IMT had specific languages of the tribe. And so a lot of people really felt like the International Military Tribunal did not go out of its way to make it possible for the Jews to make a larger contribution. And so it was an immediate disappointment, but it was a long-term success, because as a result of the International Military Tribunal, more than 100 tons of documents were collected. And at the end of the proceedings, those documents were scattered into archives in Europe, the United States, after 1948, in Israel, and eventually at Yad Vashem. And those documents, which you can see a photograph of American staffers working with over there on the far side, those documents were used by a man named Raoul Hilberg to publish what is considered to be the really foundational work of Holocaust studies, and that is the destruction of the European Jews. Raoul Hilberg relied almost exclusively on documents from the IMT to produce the destruction of the European Jews, and he really started a field. Without the IMT documentation, without Hilberg using those files, the American public, it would have taken perhaps a decade and a half longer for the American public to start seriously discussing the Holocaust. And so I will end today by saying that whereas the International Military Tribunal was not a Holocaust trial, it did end up having long-term success and significantly impacting what Americans know about the Holocaust today. Thank you.